all the primitive types the simpler types, right? Basically, it cannot have nil values. That is the first point. If you try to have that, it will basically throw an error. But let's say if I write a statement like this, obviously it doesn't know what type it is, like when you assign a nil to it. So this will also error out.
You cannot use var and equal to same.
Sorry, my bad. Thank you. Okay, so use of untype nil, this will also fail. And let's say I'm writing string and x is equal to nil. So cannot use nil as thing. So this will not work for basic types. Given that, but the nils will be working for all the other types. So you know that like when you declare a variable or when you create something, default values are given for it. For the primitive types like boolean, it is false. For string, it's empty. Those kind of things. All these I've mentioned, right? Like pointers and interfaces and channels, slice and maps, function type. These all take nil as a default value. So which means it can accept nil as a value. To put it other way, when you create a pointer to some slice or some variable, it doesn't really know what it have to assign to. So which means it basically takes nil as a value. So all good. Like any questions here? Like we can discuss more like whenever you guys want. Okay. And second basic thing is you said new, right? Like still exploring. Do you guys know what slice is? Like anyone? Sorry? Right. Okay. Correct. So I mean, in other languages, or people compare it's almost similar to C++. When you create an array or something, like you have a pointer to an array as a thing which you can say reference in C++. But here there's no such concept because slices, when you create, it's by default reference. So for the new people, like let's say I create a value, let's say array like this, and it's an int. If I create something like this, this is basically called a slice. Whereas people, at least I have never used an array as such. You can use array also. Like if you create a list of values with a predefined limit, it is actually called array. The difference is when you try to pass it to a function, arrays is copy by value, but whereas the slices are references. So let's see, I have a small piece of code to express that. So let's see, okay. All good. So if you notice here, this is an array mutate, which explains that. This is a list of three integer things. I'm calling a function called mutate, and you're trying to assign a value to the first element. And then I'm printing after this, okay? Like, I think most of the time I switch fast, but if you don't understand or like, if you don't get the code, please stop me, okay? So simply put, mutate is a function which takes an array, and then it try to mutate the value, and then we print it inside, and we also print it outside of the function. So let's just see the output of it. So when you try to mutate, it actually changes the value, but that is within the function context. But the moment you are out of the function, it didn't really change the value, which means it was a copy of that values. And the moment you are back to this particular location, you're back with this old original thing, which is never changed. So now let's just see the slices. So this doesn't mention any size, so which means it's a slice and it's a reference. So now if I try to do it, it is actually mutated, like even outside of the function. Cool, cool. So, yes. I mean, okay, basically you are asking whether nil is a type or What is it? For me, I think it's just a value which you can use. Like, probably you can assume it's a constant sort of thing, but not really a type. If it is a type, you can create something of that type, right? No, it is not associated with any particular type, right? You can assign it to a slice, you can assign it to a map, you can assign it to a pointer, which means it's just a default value. It is not nothing like a type.
It's the value of the interface thing. So every type implements interface, right? So that's why I think pointers, slices, maps, everything. Nil is zero value of all these things because they are also implement the default interface. I think it's the zero value of interface type.
It's a special value.
The interface which you're talking about, interface which doesn't have a type, that is different. Like, people try to use it instead of generics, but that is a different thing. Like, that shouldn't be confused with nil.
Yeah, but that is a default bottom type or something that you call.
Correct. Like, if you assume like Java base object, something like that,
base
that
object
is interface. But nil has nothing to do with that. Nil.
It's not zero value of that.
No, it is zero value of that. Like, if you create something of, let's say, you don't know, I don't know what is the type of the parameter which is passed here. Now I can say this as an interface. So, which means it can take anything. It can take actual values also. It can take a map, it can take an array or anything, which means this is not a type. But nil is different, where you say, I'm saying where x is a pointer to something, or where x is a, like, when you have a type struct, and then you say this is a value of it, like this is a struct value, the x can take nil. So that is different. So to summarize, I think, like, at least my perspective, nil is a value, a default value. And interface which he talked about, people tend to, it is suggested to avoid it, but instead people try to use it for generic sort of thing. Like, that is an object, just to clarify for others. So we can discuss more about nil, like, even I would love to know more about it. And where was I? Okay. So, yeah, we saw that, like, arrays and type, this is too different. Yes, I was about to say, at least I've never used arrays. We mostly use slices. The advantage being, you don't really make a copy of the actual underlying values, which means if your slices of having 1,000 values or 1,000,000 values, you're just basically passing a pointer to it and not exactly copying. So that will have a very minimal overhead, but still people think over it. And then if you want, if there is a specific use case, people can use arrays also. But at least whatever services we have written, we've never come across that situation. So that is one. Array, and this particular thing which I talked about, mutation, it holds to all slice of all the types. It is not just specific to integers. This is just an example.
Question, since you mentioned overhead of passing an array, if you have structures which contain large byte strings and strings, is it safe to pass a pointer to a struct? And let's say you have a huge pipeline of functions that you call, is it safe to just pass the pointers around, or is it like, do people just pass the value of the struct? In which case it will be copied at every stage, right?
I know I've said that statement, but mostly we never need to worry about that overhead. That overhead, I think, if we try to measure it, it is mostly negligible in our applications. But I think the way we pass struct, whether it is a pointer or a value, I think, like, it depends, right? Like, whether you know there is a mutation happening, but I correct me if I'm wrong, like, struct is also copied by, like, passed as a copy.
It's value. It's also
value. Value passed by value. So unless you want to see a change in that struct, you will ideally pass it as a values. I mean, you won't bother.
But let's say it has a byte string which is just a few kilobytes, right? Like, it's a response of a web page, and you keep passing it to, like, some lot of functions. Is there a visible overhead?
No, at least we never. I mean, you actually pass in very big object, big responses with a lot of values, but we never generally care. Like, I think you have to worry more about readability than the performance overhead, because performance is very, very, like, the overhead is very trivial. Yes.
I remember the code team was saying something about use more memory. So when they say, when you have a
memory,
it'll use more. So So when you have a structure that if you think that it's not going to limit itself, it's not going to mutate much longer than, like, it's not going to mutate in the further function, it can always pass it by value. It's not going to be a big overhead, but if you think that the mutation will happen, but happen at a level where you your struct can go rapidly,
correct,
then it's better to pass it as a pointer because you can always.
It is true. It's the statement is yes. Like, if it is too big, you will ideally want to pass it as a reference. But do we know the size? No, we don't know.
Again, like I said, when you think that the structure will grow rapidly with the functions down the lane, then yeah, it's better to pass it as a pointer. But again,
correct. The next one is very interesting. Like, it's not obviously used in anywhere, but it was a very interesting thing which I saw. This was inspired by, like, there is an awesome funny comment also. But anyways, new folks, like, anybody want to guess the output of this? Come on. This is a silly question. Yes? Everyone, yes? Anybody saying otherwise? Yeah, obviously you can think that I have the code because it's otherwise, but any guesses?
Is that a trick?
Okay, let's run it. You are hoping that play bool. Okay. Simple code, right? If it is true, print this is a silly question. If not, print otherwise, right? So let's try. Any guesses? No, it is normal true. It is just normal true value, right? It is just if true. No, the type is actually true. Primitive type is just small true. I'm not saying this is a magic. The default value, like, if you assign true, right? Like, this is a normal value. I'm not putting some other values. Any guesses? No, this is a value. If you put an expression, like, expression is like 2 plus 2 equals 4.
Yeah,
that is the expression.
So I just put 2. Make a value.
Yeah.
No, you can't put
yes.
2 actually. Like, if you just put if 2, it will throw an error saying 2 is not a bool.
Huh.
So if
here,
if value is always valid
so
to a particular bool.
Actually evaluates the expression to get the go has something related to that. You can't put 2 plus 2 and expect that you just put 2.
No, no. Okay. That is a different point. Like, 2 plus 2 is a value. In other languages, JavaScript or something, or I don't know which other languages, if you put non-zero, it is actually true.
Yeah, but that's not the case in Golang.
That's not the case in Golang. So here I'm actually putting this normal primitive type true, but you're expecting this is a silly question, but we are getting the other case.
If you try to print true, then you will get true. Because, I think it's trying to execute the return value, and that's what.
Okay, I think I'm confusing you guys. It's okay. Don't worry too much. It's just normal true. But there is one thing. It's actually sort of a constant. And I have a other file. This is within the same package. And I'm basically assigned the true to false.
Shit. I didn't think it was keywords as variables.
Yeah, it's possible. Like, even I was surprised. That's why I have it here. So it had a... Another abusive term. It's like in
this impact will be throughout the package.
Yes. If you hate someone, if you hate your project, you can do this.
I never think you could shadow reserve keywords actually. Like, wow.
So yes. Let's try. If 2 equals 2, no, this will not, I mean, this will be basically evaluated true, this should be true, let's see, yeah, this should be true. So it's like, you can directly relate it to C++, no, C macros, I think. You can do hash define, I think. And then you can basically replace anything you want. But it's not exactly like that, but it's just that you could replace the true value.
Is there any, like, Golang is going to show something? Can you run Golang?
Okay, sure.
Good. Try Go with.
awesome comment, like happy debugging, like more shitty words, and then people have put this. It was interesting to see in Golang also. My friend actually told me, and then
did you get a chance to put it in the issues of Twitter and see why this?
No. We can, if it looks scary, we can actually ask, but there would be some reasons behind it. For me, it just looks like it's just a constant value, right? And then you can use it, but it's still like we couldn't comprehend a lot. We can explore more. Sure, we can explore more.
But you're sure this is only within that package, right?
Yes.
The type of that room, if possible.
Which one?
The type of that room.
What do you want to do?
It should be boolean, right?
Signing
false.
Which one? Nil. Replacing, I don't know, let's try. Nil is equal. Yeah. Ah, shit. Yeah, that should be possible. False should be possible. But let's try, like we've assigned nil. So let's see where x string, no, not x string, let's say int, and x is equal to nil. Huh? No, we've really replaced it, right? What is it? It says, okay, let's, what do you want to use? It's failing in other places, I think. Let's just print nil, right? Let me go here and do a build. Cannot use nil type handler async. Yeah, I think it messes up my whole package, so I don't want to do that.
No, I guess that works. This is good because in a lot of other places you'll be using nil, right? Whereas when you're saying const true to false, it was also a boolean type.
Yeah.
So that's why that's the most biggest clusterfuck that can happen.
Okay, anyways, I don't want to do that now. We can explore that later. Seems like that it is breaking the other things, but we can explore more. So mostly I'm assuming like whatever the values we could assign, mostly it should be replaceable. So yeah, this was a very interesting thing, silly though, but yes. So the other one is function receivers. Two points around it. One is the basic one. For the new folks, right, like I'll also give you some context. Let's go to receivers. So you can imagine this as a almost like a class, and this has a members in it, like values. And basically, if you want to add or attach a method to it, so this says, hey, this is actually going to the code particular struct. And this is actually called method receivers. Like here, if you put values, this is basically called method receivers. And this particular like other folks, like who are new, if you want to change a value, like here I'm basically doing q.quote is equal to some other value, and I'm actually setting a quote, passing it as a parameter. And then if I set, like here I have a quote, like default one, and then I'm trying to change it with the function, and then I'm trying to change it like normally, like it's a struct, so I can assign it values, and then I'm printing it. So like who are new, like, are you guys getting it, like what I'm doing here? Just trying to mutate the struct value, one of the values of the struct. So so first quote is some code, second one is we change something else, and third one is modify. So let me just change the main. Check receivers. Let's just do it. Okay, so ideally we would have expected a first value here, and second we change the value, and third one is modified, right? Like you see what I'm saying, right? Like you would have expected debug is don't remove bugs, but it is not changing the value. So the simple thing is here when you pass or create a method receiver, like methods around it, this method receiver is on value of the structs. You can define method receivers in two ways. One is you can create a pointer here, and then if you want to change anything, the method receiver should be a struct. I mean, initially, like when you start with the language, and if you write code, like this will be a thing. Like, oh my god, why it's not mutating? But this is a very simple thing mentioned in specs. So now if we try to change the value. I change, like here I need to change the ampersand. Sorry? Oh my god, sorry. And then now if I try it, it will actually fail. Let me wait just a sec. Q1 is a type. Okay, yes, var Q1 is a quote. And then if I assign Q1 to it. So it is actually mutating, if you notice now. So the first value is the default quote, and the second one is the mutated one, and third one is a different value. But what I was looking for is I basically have a method on the pointer, like the method receiver is a pointer, but I'm calling on the default type, and it's working. So that's why I was surprised. Maybe I'm missing something. Sorry, just a sec. Okay, I don't know. I'm missing something. Sorry, I diverted. But anyways, I'll go back to that later. So the method receiver should have a pointer if you want to change the value of the members inside that struct.
I think you can just do ampersand Q1 dot.
Which one?
Line 1. Ampersand Q1. Inside brackets.
You got what I tried to do, right? Like the function shouldn't be available for the pointer.
It'll auto convert, I think. It'll auto convert. Go auto convert.
Auto converts?
Yeah,
no.
It auto converts. If you try to call it with the pointer and stuff like that, Go will auto. Yeah.
Okay.
So that's something that Go does automatically, which is one of the other reasons why.
No. I think in some case, if it is based on a type, you have to have the type. I think pointer. If you have a pointer, you can call the methods if it is a value, also pointer. But if it is just a value, you can't call a method which is on a pointer. Yes. But I know it worked here. That's why I was surprised.
I think go auto-converts if you're not right. Which makes it hard to debug also in some cases.
Okay, I'll just try last one time. So I'm having a method receiver which is a pointer, and I just have a value here, and it is not a pointer. And let's just see. So go build. It's actually passing. It should ideally throw a compiler error itself. Fine. I think I'm missing something here, but it's okay. We'll ignore that for now.
I think go auto converts based on the type being sent, right?
Okay.
Reference or value.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. So this made sense, right? Like point, it should be method receivers, and people suggest use method receivers if you can, if you want to change the values, and there is also other suggestion saying if you are generally thinking about it, just put pointer. That is also there, but be wary of the fact that if you are seeing a pointer, it can mutate the content of the struct, and then it can actually change the values. So just keep that in mind. That's it. And just one small point is when you iterate through a map or any array values, it's just random. That is just a point which I just added. And when we try to iterate through an array, right? And when you want to change the value in the same time, let's say you have an array of 5 elements, and then you want to multiply each of the element by 2 or 10, then if you try to use range, it will not work. You basically need to use index for that. So I'm basically saying something like this. So for so if you try to do this, this will not mutate the value. You have to use indexing for it to work. That's what I'm saying. So let's just try. Let me just comment this. So this doesn't work because you are iterating through a range, which itself gives a it doesn't give you a pointer. Like even if it is a pointer array, it will not work because range just gives you a copy. If you want to do that, you have to actually do something like this. You can forget about this and data of I is equal to this. Yes. So you can see like 1000 we mutated, but 3 and 5 became 6 and 10. Like it's just a small point. Like if you want to mutate, you can't just iterate and then change the values. You have to use the index, like sort of your iterating over index and then changing the value. So that was another point I had. Like any questions till now? Everybody with me? Cool. Yes.
So if you have a goroutine inside that line and you pass in the address of, let's say you have I comma b, the value, and you pass in the address of b, is it the same address? Scan the array, is the same value copied to that?
It's a new value address.
Huh. Will the address of the value be the same?
No, that's what they said, right? Like range, even if you try to use a pointer of this particular value you're asking, and if you try to change it or whether it is a goroutine or here, it will not change it. It's just a copy.
Okay. And let's say the array has three items, right? Let's say you do I comma b, and as you scan the array, the values will be copied into the variable b, right? But the address of the variable b remains constant throughout the scan, right? If I'm not wrong. It's the same variable b is used throughout the iteration, right?
That, I don't know, but still, like, what is the concern there?
So the concern there was, if you're spawning different goroutines to operate on, if you want to do a parallel map or something like that, then it might affect if you're passing the address of B because all of them will get the same value at the end of it.
Okay, I get what you're saying.
That was one other gotcha, I think, which is worth mentioning here.
Okay, basically you're telling this, something like this. Okay, and so I can actually do a
printl and sleep of some milliseconds. And
okay.
And I'm sending the address of B.
You want to send? I mean, this is already available here. What do you want to do?
Okay, fine. Yeah.
Okay. So now. Whatever the content at that time, I think that will be available. So let's just do I times second, or you want to do? Okay, let's just experiment at 2 seconds. We'll add it. Value v, let's say time dot sleep, 10 seconds. So let's just try this. Yeah.
So this is another gotcha, right? So people might think like we're doing parallel processing on a list. You might definitely have to pass it into the goroutine and then receive it as a value in the function. I think that's one nice pattern that you can send it as a value. If you send b there.
Here.
Receive b.
No. Some names. So give some other names.
Yeah, you can same name is also fine.
Okay.
B int and then send in b when you call it.
Okay. Oh yes.
This
yes.
Is a good
correct. Yes, I think.
So now you'll get the list of values if you're doing some parallel processing on a list.
Correct. So this was mentioned in some worker or something. I remember. They suggest to pass the values. So for others, right, to give more context, here we have we are actually iterating through a list of values, this data, and then imagine this is a million rows. And then basically we are trying to concurrently add all the values. Let's just say And then it's not add values. Let's say every value you're trying to do some very complicated operation, which takes 5 seconds. And rather than doing it in like iterative way, you span goroutines for all the values, million requests. Million values will result in million threads. So if you try to access the value directly, like whatever is this here, like it's a sort of a closure, right? This V is directly available. But if you try to access it, like you noticed here, everything at that time, whatever that value is, it will get that. It is not what you intended. But what he was saying and like what is it is suggested is, whatever you want to access, pass it explicitly as a parameter to that goroutine so that you will have that value when you need it. So like 351, we got it perfectly. So that was the point. Thank you for that. And okay, that is one. Yes, this is, okay, this is a small point, but we will see a very small example after this. Now I think like others should have asked a question, but it's okay. Here if you noticed, we added a time dot sleep here. Anybody want to guess like why did we add that? Yes, so the thing is, if you don't actually give the value, if you have 10 goroutines, your function will or your program will stop before the goroutine completes. So if we try to run this right, you won't actually see all the values. It just dies. But your goroutine is still executing, because of which we had to give time sleep. But it is generally not suggested to give time sleep because you will not know how much time the goroutine takes. So there is something called waitGroup. WaitGroup. It's like you can have a group and then you can add all the goroutines. Hey, I have 10 goroutines. And each goroutine, I'm going to say, hey, I have 10 workers. And then whenever the goroutine completes, it will add a value to the worker, wait group. And then when it completes, your program will complete. So you have to say wait group dot wait. So that is generally suggested. So the point here is, you're trying to make an external HTTP call. You're trying to make a processing in goroutine. And if you don't wait for it, that goroutine will not complete and your program will not wait for it. So that's the point. I'll show the code. Like I have a different example.
Just a theoretical question here. Like, you know, that in the Node.js world, right? Even if there is one callback waiting on an event, right? The entire program will not end. Actually, why didn't you go follow that model? Like, even if there's one live routine, why quit the program?
I don't know. It's their decision. I don't know whether there is an article which mentioned like the decision there, right? Philosophy for it.
The main is not waiting. Actually, you actually spun up the new process. It's actually
I don't know the specific reason for it. Obviously, they could have done it if they wanted. It's not a big deal. But I don't know the philosophy behind it. Like, I think Java also does it similar, right? Like, I think you have to do a thread dot wait and then sleep for it, all those things. Maybe we can relate to that. But I'm not sure why this is the case and not the other way around.
In most TCP servers, I guess it's
not. And the other ways is to use channels for synchronization.
So the other point, like I have a code, I'll walk you through it, and then this is a problem even we have faced. I'll walk you through it, and then I'll tell you what I'm trying to explain. So for the people who is new to Go, like this is a server, like this is all a server. Whenever you basically I have two routes, like ping, this service can give ping, and then I have a handler, I'll show what it is, and then I have panic, like forget about panic for now, and I'm listening on the port, like this is all starting a server, and ping handler, it takes a response writer and request, you use this to write the response to it, and then this is a request object, like whatever the post body or parameters you get. So here what this service trying to do is, whenever I hit a ping, I'll get a response pawn, okay? And I also have another function which is called getCoat. This is trying to mimic a service. Imagine when you have a service and then you are exposing API, you will obviously have a dependency in terms of microservices. And let's say you will wait for some time because the other dependency is taking time to respond. So this getCoat is actually hitting this URL, and this is a get call, and I'm waiting for 3 seconds. This is a imitated processing time, and I'm actually doing a request out with context. I'll talk about more about context here, and then like let's go through the code for now. And then I'm making a call, like I'm using a default HTTP client, a default client of HTTP, and I'm making a request. And so here I'm basically decoding it and then printing the code which I got from the other service. So when I hit this call, it just returns a response pawn, but it also same time hits another service, gets a code and prints it. And if you want to see the decode logic, it just JSON new decode, and I'm trying to decode it to a quote, and this is basically like the JSON others to this type. I can just show you one thing. So call. I don't know whether I have connected. Yes. So whenever I hit this API, I get a random code. That is a service which I'm depending on. And then I'm calling Pong. Like everybody with me in this code, like anyone have any questions? If you don't get it, please ask. So now let's hit the API. Let's just make it run async serve. So it is serving request now. So let's just hit call HTTP localhost colon 8080 ping. So it waits for 3 seconds, and then here it gave me a response pawn. But assume this is a side effect, right? Here I'm printing the code which I got from the service. Okay, so context is something which you can pass around all the functions downstream. Let's say you are calling from the handler, you are calling a service, service calls a repo, you can pass a context. It can contain some values, so that like you some value you, which you want to share across, but not exactly you can put struct or anything. Just any values which you want to share within the request context, which means if the request is completed, that value shouldn't make any sense. You can put that in context. And this particular piece of code, if you, here you have seen, this is getting values from parent, and then it's making a request. Ideally, people use context with timeout, with deadline, so that, hey, I know I'm going to take only 2 seconds to respond to this request, but I don't care whether you take 5 seconds or 10 seconds, you have to give me response within 1 second. So people set deadline. So in this case, it was a synchronous one. So now let's just change the side effect to goroutine, right? And what do you expect as output? Like, so we had a synchronous call. It returned pong, but as a side effect, we got a quote and then printed it. Now I just made it as a goroutine. You ideally expect the response to be very quick, not waiting for a 3 second, and printing the quote later point of time. Like, anybody have guesses like what will happen? Any other issues you think here? Okay, let's just run it.
Not wait for the response. The response.
Yes. So basically, you are saying Pong, it will be immediate, and the code will be printed later point of time. That is your what you are saying. Okay, I mean it will be printed before. Okay, cool, let's try. But I have a wait on 3 seconds, right? And then I'm making a goroutine, so it will be, sorry. I'm building this, and then now I'm making a request. So the pong is immediate, because that was a goroutine. But ideally, you expect the service side effect to happen. But now you're actually facing the issue. So this is what I wanted to talk about. Like, if there was a deadline, you can expect the other goroutine to die. But here, we didn't give any deadlines here. So if you notice here, I have a ping handler. And this ping handler doesn't send anything. It just takes whatever the R request is. It just sends the context. For here, we can set the deadline and all with time. Where is it? OK. Anyway, we can set deadlines, but we didn't set it. But why it died? That is the question here. So the reason is the point which we stated earlier, right? Obviously, the program doesn't wait for the other goroutine. But since this is a service, it takes a different turn, I think. Your parent, there is two things here. One, your parent, which is the one which is calling the goroutine, and the actual goroutine. And you're actually using something called context. And if the parent dies, this will immediately die. Like, not exactly the parent died, but the parent context actually completed. So the goroutine underneath it is also complete, like will complete. So that is what it says. Here it says context canceled because the parent completed very quickly. So let's say we are actually saying time.sleep 5 second here. Then this shouldn't be a problem. So this will obviously print the code before and then respond to the pong later. So you got it. So we had a parent context, and then there was a goroutine which executed, which shared the parent's context. I mean, the context, and then it spawns another context for the child. And then if the parent doesn't wait for it, it will immediately kill that thing. And then that is the error which we see here. So yes, it's not deadline. It's just a gotcha that, like, 2 points to mention here. One is, obviously, your service will take time, like the other dependent services. Always use requests with some deadline or timeout so that your response time will not increase. You have to handle degraded responses. And second thing is, for these, be wary of the context which you are passing. So you have to know that, oh, if you want to get the response of that, you have to either wait for it or add it to a channel, those sort of thing. To fix it other way around, you can also do one thing. You can say this is a background process, and let's just wait for 2 seconds. Context.background. Yes. So here we are explicitly saying, hey, I know that this is going to take long time, and then I'm saying this is a background process. So here, if you notice, the pong completed. And also the child, which is actually hitting the service, that is also completed. Cool. Got it? Like, any questions here? Sorry? Okay.
So, what if your that response, like your code service response, is actually dependent on this one? So, the pong response that you're giving,
correct,
it also needs that code. So, what if you...
Obviously, you will make it as a synchronous call. You will not spawn a goroutine. But imagine, like, that is the ideal case. But you cannot ensure the dependent services response time to be quick. And since it is a microservices, always there will be 3-4 microservices, like other services, which you will be dependent on. And we have always seen, like, the other services, one of the services can go down. So in that case, you won't wait and then fail the response. You should ideally handle the, like, all the requests parallelly, and then at one point of time, you need to have a contract saying, hey, I will respond within 5 seconds for the user. And if I don't get one response, you cancel it or you give a partial response, people call it. Like, if it is a profile, partial response will make sense. But if it is something like transactions, there is some complicated architectures, which is like, make that transaction, let's say debit and credit, right? I'm parallelly debit and credit. Like, ideally, you shouldn't do, but I'm just saying, you credit it. But debit fails, then you have to make another call to debit here. So those sort of things you can do, like in complicated systems. and if the response is your main concern. But to answer your question, simply, if the response time is very low, you can call it asynchronous and then respond to this current request after that response.
But if that is, you
don't have
deadline.
You don't have to, but you should ideally think about the deadline and then keep your contract within 5 seconds. That's what I'm saying. It's okay. Like, let's say I'm putting a random value, 10 second, 15 second, right? It will take longer time, but the user, you're building a service for somebody else, right? Like, they shouldn't wait for that long. So that was the point. I mean, for this, like, do we have time? At least in our case, we've always used in application levels, and not the HA proxy level, like the request proxy. We have never done that. I don't know whether you can do it, but we've done it in client sites. That is most of the cases. So the server can take any time, but the client, we always expect a response within 5 seconds or let's say 2 seconds. If we don't get it, we cancel it. So that we have mostly done it. Yeah, middleware goes into the server and server handles, okay, all the requests. I'm going to say all of you have to respond within 2 seconds. Middleware is also possible. Like request context, people generally have middleware context set a deadline there, like timeout. So that's possible. But to give others context, right, like the why it is important is when you have so much load and when you have so many requests coming in, imagine you have 10 systems and then you are dependent on so many other services. If your response time takes longer and longer, user will try to hit you again and again. And then that will eventually result in lot of load in your system. And then your system will eventually go down and then that will ripple in the whole microservices architecture. So that's why in the clients, you have to be wary of like, okay, you have to assume that server can always go down and then deal with it. And server, you always have to assume that, okay, I will have to respond within 2 seconds. If not, I'll give a dummy response or cannot process it that time. If not, your infra will be a bottleneck for you. So that being said, like, there is a lot of things around HTTP which I wanted to cover, like since most of us write HTTP services. But pretty much we talked about it. One is set timeouts. And second thing is it's a very minor thing, but I can show you here. Here, I'm reading a response to a structure. And if you don't close the body, this will result in a file descriptor leak. What I mean is like you have a number of limits on a file descriptors. Let's say you are dealing with 20K requests per minute. And eventually, if you're not closing it, this is basically a leak, which means your service at some point of time will not have a new file descriptor to serve the new request. So to put more context, So this is the, like right now it's unlimited, but generally it is, here it is. It's only 7,000 requests, but let's say you are dealing with 20K requests, the system cannot handle it. And like, if you respond to the request immediately, it's not an issue. But imagine request piling up or you're not closing the file descriptor, then you're running out of the file descriptor and your service is down. Like people cannot use your service. So close the body always, like wherever you're reading and whether you're reading it or not, you have to close the body. But there is one catch here. If you close the body here and if the response is nil, then this will panic because the response will not have a body. So always close it after there is no error. And in the document which I read, there is one minor case when you are redirected and that time you will have no errors and you will not have any body. So people also suggest to check the body non-nil also in some time, just one case. So close the body. And this I've never used, but this was very interesting for me to see. So what they mentioned is, here I'm closing the body, but even if I close the body here, we are actually decoding to a structure. And here, let's say there is a case where you're not consuming the response 100%. Like you're partially consuming the response, you're assigning it to a struct. And if there is more response you have not decoded, then it will result in a leak, they've said. And they said, like, this is the way you can actually clear it. I've never used it, but like this was an interesting point which I've read in that article. This is another one. And one more point is, imagine you have microservices and obviously you have another server and you are the client and you are loading the other server. You don't, like, there is something called HTTP like reuses, like HTTP connection reuse, right? And then this, you have to tell the other server, hey, close the connection once you responded to me. If not, the other server will have a lot of file descriptors in it. So for that, it is suggested to have, where is it? It is suggested to have request.close. You can just say request close is equal to true. R.close equal to true. This will say, for client request setting, this will feel like, in the server, it will close the connection after that. It will not try to reuse it. So if not, you can set a header, which is alternative. So this is also suggested if you are having very high load systems.
So if you have another goroutine which connects to the same upstream server, will it reuse the existing TCP connection?
Yes, yes. Like ideally, whenever you have a high load systems, people will have a pool of HTTP connections because you don't want to go through the overhead of creating a connection and then closing a connection.
In that case, then we don't want
to... Huh, yes. Like it is just the scenario where, like, if you know that you are calling different service and not exactly calling the same server, it is suggested to close.
This will clean up all the TCP resources at OS level, is it?
Like, no, it's just that, like, they will handle it however they want to. You are actually asking him to close the connection once it is served your request. That's it. And this is another interesting one, recovery. So we'll go to this place now. So for other people, panic is something like an exception which the system cannot handle. And ideally, it is suggested you should never panic. Let's say you're trying to see a file, or don't panic, like don't throw exception, that sort of thing. Always log it. But let's say you are trying to access a value out of a nil, or like there is some error in your code, and then always panic will happen in that case. So panic is almost equivalent to exception. Given that context, let's say this is another API, like I'm gonna hit panic, another URL. What it does is it just accepts a request and then it panics. That's it. And let me just comment this out. Like I have another handler, but we'll go through this later. Okay, so let me just run that panic thing, hit that panic. So if you do this, the service can go into a state, like ideally it will die, but since it's a service, it's still running. Let's see whether it can serve other requests. It is serving, but in other cases, it will actually break. And then, You should never go into the state. Though you have code which can break, and then which there is minor cases, it is always suggested to like you catch exception, right? You have to recover from the panics. So since it is a service which is always running, you have to recover from it. So this particular piece of code, recover, like this is the one which will catch the panic, whatever which is thrown in the underlying place. I'll just go show you here and then we'll come back to here. So here I'm actually wrapping it in another middleware. Like others, you can actually talk to me later. Like it's like you're calling me and then I'm calling somebody else. So I'm the middleware, something like that. So panic handler will recover if this function throws a panic, sort of panics. So, and this is a panic handler middleware which we wrote. and this is the actual call which we are making to the other other ping or pong, whatever services you will call. And let's say if there is any issues, right, you can recover from it, and you should always use the recovery inside a defer. So given that, now we are trying to, there is a code which panics. Also, we wrote a middleware which tries to recover from the panic. So let's just build that. And then now, let's just see ping, let's just panic now. And then, okay. So now if we noticed, it didn't throw the error. Our system actually handled that. Like ideally you should handle here, like based on the error type, you can handle it. If not, you shouldn't leave the panics just like that. You should always have a very high level middleware in your service, which deals with the panic. So that any code, anywhere something wrong happens, your service will still run properly. So that was about the recovery. And these are all some of the things which I noted in HTTP. And this is an article which has a lot of gotchas and 50 things, I think, watch out for. Like it has a very nice beginner level, intermediates and very advanced level things. And few are my learnings. So that's it. That's all I had. If you have any questions, shoot out, or you can reach out to me in mail. I can give you the mail. So this you can reach out to me in this mail, or I'm on Twitter. So any questions, it's welcome, or feedback, it's welcome. And that's all I had for today. Thank you.